Okay, so let me start by recalling the definition I introduced yesterday. So the definition of the Brilliant Map. So we start from this object, which I called the CRT. So as I explained, this is a random compact R-tree, so you should view it as an object of this form. And you have precisely it's constructed as a quotient space of the interval 0, 1, so there is a canonical projection from 0, 1 into TE, and this can also be viewed as a kind of exploration path when you explore the tree like this, so on. And we had also another important ingredient, which was Brownian labels on the CRT, which I denoted by ZA. In fact, the method I used to construct these labels was to define them, well, to parameterize them first by the interval 0, 1. Okay. So basically, we at first defined a process ZT indexed by the interval 0, 1, and then ZA is equal to ZT if A equals P of T. Okay, so okay. I will view always Z as either indexed by 0, 1 or indexed by the tree, like here, okay? Okay, and then I defined a function which I call d0 of AB. So this is defined for AB belonging to the CRT. So this is ZA plus ZB minus twice the minimal of label between A and B. So in fact, I take the maximum of the minimum of ZC for C belonging to AB and the minimum of ZC for C belonging to BA. Okay, so I think I spent some time yesterday explaining what I mean by these intervals. Okay, so if you have a point A, which is here, and a point B, which is here, while you move. In fact, you follow the exploration path from A to B in some sense. Okay. So you move from A to B following the contour of the tree, and you record the set of points that you visit, and this is the interval AB. Okay? Okay, so this was the basic definitions. And then we can introduce distar of AB. So basically, this is a maximal symmetric function of A and B that is bounded above by d0 and satisfies the triangle inequality. Okay, so the infimum of all choices of the integer k and of the points a0, a1, ak, such that a0 equals a and ak equals b of the sum of d0 ai minus 1 ai. Okay? And then what we do, this is bounded above by d0 of ab. Obviously, you just have to take k equals 1 and you get this bound. And now this satisfies the triangle inequality, clearly. And so we can view this as a pseudometric. And as usual for pseudometrics, you identify two points A and B if they are at a distance equal to zero. Okay? So the definition of the Brownian map is that M infinity is equal to the quotient space of TE for this equivalence relation. And it is equipped with the metric induced by D star. Okay, so definition is a little bit mysterious, so I will try to explain it. Basically, I will explain the reason why we introduce this D0. In fact, we will see that we can interpret that from the discrete setting. Of course, the goal today is to, not really to prove, but to give the main ideas of the proof of the theorem I stated in the first lecture. So, theorem says that if Qn is uniformly distributed over this set script capital Qn of all, or so I think in the first lecture I had put a dot here. So these are all rooted and pointed quadrangulations. With n faces.
Can I ask a simple question? How smaller is this star compared to D0? How different is it really?
Maybe I will make some comments about that. But it can be, it is in fact smaller than D0, but how much how smaller? There are specific pairs of points where the two are equal. Okay, maybe I will mention that later. Okay. Okay. Then, well, it's not very important. The result is saying that if you look at the vertex set of Qn equipped with the graph distance that you multiply by the scaling factor n to the power minus a quarter, and in fact there is this constant. Well, we already saw this constant. The last lecture, 9 over 8 to the power of a quarter, we saw where it comes from. This converges in distribution to the Brownian map which I just defined. Okay, so in Gromov-Hausdorff sense, as I explained in the first lecture. Okay, so maybe I can make several remarks about that. First is that if you have this result, it's very easy to see that the same result holds if you look at rooted quadrangulations. This is almost obvious, I don't discuss that. On the other hand, the fact that they are rooted is important in our method. Okay, so another remark, well, we can already understand why there is this factor n to the power minus a quarter. Because you remember in the bijection between quadrangulation and trees, labels corresponded to distances, essentially from this from a particular vertex. And we saw, I think yesterday, that the proper normalization for label trees, is n to the power minus a quarter. Okay, okay, basically it's because the height of the tree is of order square root of n. And then if we look at the typical size of a label by the central limit theorem, it's n to the power, it's square root of n, or n to the power a quarter. Okay, so the fact that the graph distance has to be normalized by this factor here, you can very easily guess it from what we did yesterday. So this is not really a surprise now. Okay, but I would like to say that it was not completely obvious that this was the proper scaling factor for the graph distance, but this follows from what we did. Okay, I want to make a few remarks before we proceed to the proof. So the first remark is that while there is an equivalent way of formulating this equivalence relation, one can prove that D star of AB equals zero is equivalent, in fact, to D0 of AB equals 0. Okay. So there is something which is obvious, which is, I think, from the right to the left. Okay. Obvious, because simply because the D-star is less than D0. Okay. What is not obvious is the converse implication. So you can have D-star equal 0 only if D0 is also equal to 0. And I'm not going to prove that. It's a bit technical, but basically this, okay. One has to use some rather involved properties of the Brownian labels. Okay. I'm not going to really to use it later, but I want to mention that because it gives some somewhat more concrete interpretation of this equivalent relation here. Because D0 of AB is equal to 0, if you look at the definition of D0, this is equivalent to saying that all terms in the definition of D0 are equal. Okay? So ZA equals ZB equals the maximum. Okay, so what does it mean? It means that you have your tree. Informally, so it means that if you you have your point A, which is here, say your point B, which is here. This means that they have the same label, so the value of Z is the same at A and I at B. And moreover, it's equal to one of, well, it's equal to one of these two minima. And this means that you have the same value of Z here, but moreover, you can go from A to B, well, either clockwise or counterclockwise, and visiting only vertices with larger labels. So on all these intervals here in orange, the labels are going to be greater than the label here or the label here. Okay, so it's a rather strong condition, but it can appear for certain pairs of vertices. Okay, so this is the interpretation of the identification we make here on the CRT. Well, at that point, you may ask, and this is a natural question, why in the limit we need to identify, so why do we need this equivalent relation, this identification of points? Because if you think of the discrete picture, which I explained in the first two lectures, or in the second one, I think, in the discrete setting, your quadrangulation is coded by a tree, and the set of vertices of the quadrangulation is exactly the same as the set of vertices of the tree, except that you need to add one extra vertex, but it's not important, okay? So here, if you think of the analog in the continuous setting, you see that, the Brownian map is not the same as the tree. You need to do this identification of vertices to take a quotient space, okay? So what's the reason for that? I think it's important to understand it. The reason is that if you come back to the discrete bijections, so imagine that you have a very large, that n is very large, so you have a very large tree, like that, and you remember you have labels on vertices of the trees and so on. So it may happen that even for a very large tree, you have two vertices U and V, say for instance this one here and this one here, with the property that say the label of V, so I was denoting that by LV is equal to LU minus 1, and between U and V, the labels are larger, okay? So meaning that if I go, I don't write this very precisely. Labels are at least as large as LU. Okay? Meaning that when I'm exploring here like this, I encounter only, I visit all these corners if you want, I encounter only labels greater than U and V. So if you think a little bit, it's not hard to see that even for a very large tree, it may happen that you have this situation with U and V very far away from each other in the tree. Okay. So now, when we proceed to the bijection, what do we do? Remember, I'm going to connect, say, this corner here, well, U here has only one corner, so it's not hard, to the next visited corner with smaller label. And because of these two conditions here, this will imply that U and V are connected by an edge of the quadrangulation. So I will draw a red edge, okay, like this. Okay. Now, you see, when you proceed to the scaling limit, because you scale the distance by a factor that tends to zero, it means that in the limit, these two vertices are going to be identified. Okay, there the graph distance is equal to one, but you multiply by n to the power minus a quarter, so in the limit, they have to be glued together. Okay, so, of course, this is not a proof or anything like that, but this explains that in the limiting object, the CRT, you will, okay, when you have this situation, two vertices A and B, which have the same label, so here, it was not exactly the same, but okay, the scaling limit, this gives you the same label, and such that between A and B, you have only greater labels, well, they must be identified. It's really the, if you want, the analog of the construction of edges in the Schaeffer's bijection, and the fact that you can have vertices which are at macroscopic distance, even in the limit n tend to infinity with these properties. Okay. Okay. So I think it's important to understand that.
Excuse me. So you said you pronounce a little sentence saying that the AB, the distance, the D star equals zero, or if and only if D zero is zero, and that's a property of Brownian labels. It means that it's not a deterministic property.
No, it means that okay.
It's a probabilistic.
No, what I meant is that if you want to prove this, which is not obvious, you really need to do a fine analysis of the properties of labels. Okay.
Yes, but if I, instead of Brownian labels, if I just have a huge, just an arbitrary continuous function g, is that still true?
No, I don't think
it's
so.
Really related.
No, it's, I don't think so.
Okay.
No, it's just, at least the proof I wrote does not work in general. Okay, so this was, second remark. And whilst in another remark is again, it's something I'm not going to prove, but I only mention it so that you have a better understanding of what's going on. In some sense, this condition here is rather strong. That's not going to be satisfied by many pairs of points. Okay, so. Because you remember here what it corresponds to a kind of excursion for the labels, because you want the label to be the same here, and to be greater in the interval here. So remember that the labels evolve a little bit like Brownian motion indexed by the tree. So it's something which is not so easy to satisfy. And the fact is, the equivalence classes for this. Equivalence relation typically they contain just one point. You don't identify a point with anything. There may contain two points. There is a set of Hausdorff dimension one. I should have mentioned that the tree has Hausdorff dimension two. There is a set of Hausdorff dimension one of points which are identified to another one. And there is a countable set of of classes that contain 3 points. Okay, so again, I'm not going to prove that. It's not very difficult. Well, it's a bit technical, but it's just to tell you that typically But if you pick a point at random, it makes sense because you have a volume measure on the tree. It's not going to be identified to any other point. There are only very special points that are identified to another point. Okay? And, yeah?
Is this, so the other direction, is it sort of quantitative in the sense, do you have a random constant so that the D0 is controlled by the D star?
No, that's not true, no.
That's not true.
No. Mm-hmm. No, it's very easy to see it. It cannot be true. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And just last remarks, again, something, a few things that I'm not going to prove. But you can check a lot of properties of the Brownian map. And in particular, I mentioned two properties. That the Brownian map is homeomorphic to the sphere. So here you have a random compact metric space. You can prove that almost surely it's homeomorphic to the sphere. It's not that surprising in the sense that you know what we are doing. We are considering graphs drawn on the sphere, and we put more and more faces, more and more edges, vertices, and so on. And in the limit, you could imagine that we fill the sphere, and so we get something homeomorphic to the sphere. But it's not so obvious. Okay? It requires some work. It can be proved by rather soft arguments, but you need to verify certain things. Okay? And also, in this construction, you construct the Brownian map as a quotient space of a tree. And of course, a tree is a tree. It's not at all homeomorphic to the sphere. So it means that your identifications completely change the topology. And of course, it has been known for a while that if you start from, say, for instance, a tree, or even you can start from an interval, if you do suitable identifications, you can change the topology and get, for instance, the topology of the sphere. Okay? And this is the case here. Okay? On the other hand, you can also compute the Hausdorff dimension. And prove that the Hausdorff dimension of the Brownian map is equal to 4. So the, of course, topologically, it's a sphere. So if you want, the topological dimension is 2. But the Hausdorff dimension, defined in terms of the metric, is equal to 4. So you should view this object as a sphere, but with a very irregular metric. Or you can think of a sphere with something which topologically is a sphere, but which is very very irregular, a lot of thorns or spikes. Or
this characterizes rather the metric of this space. So topologically is two-dimensional, but
yet
the metric is so complicated that it becomes four.
Yeah, exactly.
So it's a property of metric.
Yeah,
distance.
It's a property of the metric, exactly.
And another question. So could you please explain how an equivalent class can contain 3 points, if this is a reasonable question? Should we disregard them, or is this...
You want me to explain why it can be 3 points? Yeah?
No, if it's possible to give just a couple minutes.
An example for that, yeah? Well, it's quite easy, you see. Let me think about it. Okay, so you have your CRT. Take a subtree like this, okay? And somewhere you have a minimal label here. So imagine that this point is a minimal label over all these sets here, okay? Mm-hmm. And then what you are going to do, you are going to explore the tree like this.
Jean-François, is there a reason why you always choose leaves?
Yeah, the reason why I choose leaves, because you can prove that the only points that can be identified to other points are leaves. Yeah, it's not difficult to prove. Most of the tree is concentrated on leaves. Okay, so you are going to explore it, and eventually you will meet a point with the same label as here. Okay, well this may happen. Okay, I'm not giving you a proof. Okay, so you will have here a point with the same label as this one, and by construction, because this was a minimum on this tree, and here you chose the first time you meet the same label, these 2 points are going to be identified. Okay, They will have the same label, and between the labels will be larger. So you can do that. But now you can do it in the other direction. So possibly here, starting from the other way, you will again look at the first point where you get the same label as here. Okay. So these two points are also identified, and you have three points identified together. Okay. But you cannot have more. Okay. Why? Why? Because if you continue your exploration, then you will get greater label here, and here you will get, smaller labels. And here also you will get smaller labels. So this will prevent any other point to be identified to this tree. Oh, I don't want to spend too much time on that because, is it okay, my explanation? Yeah, okay. Otherwise, I will never arrive at the proof. Okay, so now, well, we have to suffer a little bit, so we have to come to the proof. Maybe I'm going to erase that, and I'm not going to use it, okay, it's not. The kind of properties that you can derive then with a little more work, So I don't pretend to give a proof, so it's going to be a sketch of proof. Of theorem. And well, maybe the first step. No, maybe I should write on the tablet board. So the first step is a property of Schaeffer's variation. So what is this property? So remember the bijection, I was considering a quadrangulation Q with n faces. And I was associated with Q, a tree, say tau, and a collection of labels on this tree. Okay? And so this belongs to the set I called capital Tn. Okay, and I can list here the vertices, or more precisely, introduce what I called the contour sequence. And if you remember well, what we are doing, we are just again exploring the tree and recording the vertices that we visit when we explore the tree in contour order. Okay, so the observation I want to make now is that if I look at the graph distance, so I insist here on the fact that the graph distance in Q, of course, between the vertex ui, so remember that the vertices of the tree are identified to vertices of Q. Okay. I want to say that there is a bound for this distance, which is obtained by taking the label of ui plus the label of uj minus twice the minimal label between I and j, so the minimum of LUK for k between I and j. Okay? So this is safe for a, I smaller than j. Okay. Well, probably I must add a plus 2 if I want this to be correct. So, sorry. Plus 2 here. Plus twice. Okay, so we have this bound, and how is it proved? I'm going to do the proof on a picture. My picture is not good enough. Yeah. I will redo it. So you have your tree. It does not have to be big, but I draw a big tree so that perhaps the argument will be easier to follow. And okay, maybe something like this. Okay, so suppose my vertex UI is somewhere here. Well, suppose for instance it's this one. It does not have to be a leaf. It could be any vertex. And UJ comes later. Okay, so maybe UJ is here. Okay. And now remember how we construct edges in the quadrangulation Q. Okay, so from this corner here, I can choose any corner of UI to start with. I draw an edge to the next corner with a smaller label. So maybe it's this one. Okay. And well, then I will start again from the same corner where I arrived, and I draw an edge to the next corner with smaller label. Maybe it's this one here. Okay. And eventually, I'm going to arrive at a corner whose label is a minimum label between UI and UJ. Okay. So maybe it's this one here. Okay. Okay. So this is a corner with minimal label between UI and UJ. Okay? Of course, there is such a corner, such a vertex. I could have said a vertex, in fact. I don't need to. Okay. Okay, so what's going to happen next? Well, at the next time, well, I will have to jump, in fact, above UI, because clearly, for all these vertices here, the label is going to be at least as large as this one, because this one is the one with minimal label. So I will go somewhere, maybe here. Okay. Mm-hmm. So, so maybe I give a name for this minimal label. I will call it, say, L bar like this. Okay, so here I arrive at label L bar minus one, because each time I draw an edge, I decrease the label by one. Okay, so now what's going to happen if I play the same game from UJ? Okay, so I start from the first corner of UJ here, and okay, I draw an edge to the next corner with a smaller label. It may be this one, so, and I continue this one. But you see that eventually I will have also to arrive at this corner here, okay? Because, well, in fact, this corner here, or this vertex, if you prefer to say this corner, it's more correct, is the first one that you encounter after UJ with label L bar minus one, okay? So eventually, your path here, it will do something like this, and then it will arrive here. Okay. Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay, but now, if you think of it a little bit, you have each of the two red paths. I should have taken a different color, but each of the two paths, one starting from UI, the other one starting from UJ, is a piece of is a geodesic, in fact. Because each time I am decreasing the label by one, and this is what I call the simple geodesics in the second lecture, I think. It's a piece of a geodesic to the eventually all the geodesic will arrive at the vertex which I call the partial D in the second lecture. Okay, so each of the two red paths here is a geodesic. Well, in fact, I'm not even sure I need that, d'ailleurs. In fact, but you can compute the length of each of these paths. So the length of the first path, so let's call this one V. So you have a path from UI to V with lengths. Well, the length will be simply the difference of labels, since each time you decrease the label by minus one. So the length will be LUI minus LV, minus L bar plus one. And you also have a path from UJ to V with lengths, the same thing, LUJ minus L bar plus one, okay? But now if you look at the concatenation of these two paths, it gives you a path from UI to UJ, okay? Donc what you get is that the distance between UI and UJ, UQ, is bounded above by the sum of these two quantities. LUI minus L bar plus one plus LUJ minus L bar plus one. Okay. And this is indeed the bound which I have written here. Okay? You see that you get LUJ, LUI plus LUJ, like this, like here. And this L bar is the same as this minimum. Okay? This quantity precisely is a minimal label between UI and UJ. Okay? Okay. So you get the bound. Okay? Is it approximately clear? It's a consequence, really, of the discrete construction of edges in the Schaeffer bijection. Okay, so this is interesting because it also explains the relevance of this definition D0. You see, this D0 is really the analog of the quantity which is here. Well, the two plays no role. Okay, the two will disappear in the scaling limit. But otherwise, D0 is just a kind of continuous version of this quantity. So you may say that, oh, there I have a maximum. I can take the minimum of label from A to B or from B to A. In fact, I could have obtained also such a maximum here. Okay, just if you look at the argument, I could have obtained exactly the analog of what I have in the continuous setting. Okay? So basically, the fact that the distance d star here, the right distance for the Brillouin map, has to be smaller than this D0, it's because in the discrete setting we already have this bound, in fact. Okay, mm-hmm. Okay, that was the first step. So, before I come to the second step, I will introduce some notation. Okay, so I'm proving this theorem here, and so I'm going to introduce the quadrangular, the label tree which is associated with Qn. Okay, so Qn corresponds to a label tree Tn so this one is uniform over my set of labeled trees with n edges, okay? And we introduced in the last two lectures a number of quantities related to these objects. Well, again, the contour sequence, un0, un1, un2n. And we introduced the contour function. It was c to n of I equals the height of the vertex U and I. And the label function, maybe I should write it like this, to n. L to n of I, it's the label of the vertex U and I, okay? And basically what we did yesterday was getting, and in fact the day before also, was getting a limit scaling limit for these two processes, so I recall it. So the result, I call it star, that's going to be an important ingredient of the proof. If we rescale properly the contour function, so 1 over square root of 2n, c to n of 2nt, and properly also the label function. Okay, then we get a convergence in distribution toward the limit, which is the Brownian excursion, and this process Zt. Okay. So maybe I should keep that so that you remember the notation. And maybe, okay, I don't erase that for the moment. Here I think I can erase everything except the theorem. Okay, so just now the second step of the proof. Well, we are going to use this fact here, and so I will give a name, in fact, to this quantity here. We'll call this d0 of ij. So define. So here, I will rewrite the definition because it's going to be useful. So for I and j between 0 and 2n, I call d0 n of ij. This depends on n now because okay, I'm going to vary n, it's very important. This will be the same as this quantity, but now I emphasize that everything depends on n. Okay. So here k has to be between I and j, so I'm not assuming that I is smaller than j, so I take k between I infimum j and I supremum j. So plus 2. Okay. And I'm also going to define dn of ij, which is the graph distance now in Qn between u and I and uij. Okay? So this is really the thing we are interested in. We want to control all distances between vertices of Qn, and this is given by these quantities. So this one is only an upper bound. Okay, what the first step tells us is that this is always smaller than d0n of ij. Okay? On the other hand, this object is the one we can easily study because it's defined in terms of labels. And while we have a limit result for the convergence of labels. Okay, so I remind you the notation ln u n I. By definition, this is what I call the L to n of I. Okay, so we have this limiting result here. Okay, so essentially, what we can immediately say. Is that, well, we have a scaling limit for these quantities. Okay, so we have, so I'm, okay, from time to time I'm going to forget this constant, which is not very important. So I look at these quantities. Well, you can take a linear interpolation of this object if you want. Maybe I should do it. So I don't put integer values. And you look at these for st between 0 and 1. And I'm saying that this converges in distribution. Well, you just use the definition, the fact that the labels, they are related to this process here. And this process here, if we scale it like this, we know it converges to Z. So what we will get in the limit is simply Zs plus Zt minus twice the minimum for R between S and T of Zr. Okay. So this is really a consequence of the star here. Okay. Okay. You write this object as L to n of I, this one as L to n of j, this one as the minimum of L to n of k. Okay, between I and J, and you just pass to the limit using the convergence here. Okay. Now, what is nice here is that you get your limiting process here is continuous in the pair ST. Okay. I'm going to use that. My idea is to. Okay, I will explain that in a while. My idea is to get tightness property, not for these processes. For these processes, I already have the tightness because I have the convergence, but for the one without the zero, for these ones, which correspond to the real ones I want to study. Okay. So, but I'm going to express the fact that I have a convergence here to a limiting process which is continuous to derive some information about this d0n. Okay. So what I can say, for instance, consequence of that for every I should be careful for every epsilon positive I can find a delta positive such that if I look at the probability that the soup, I'm going to look at these objects. I'm going to look at the probability that the soup of these objects, d0n, okay. Let me not forget the scaling factor. d0n, say 2ns, 2ns prime, say. I'm going to look only at values s and s prime such that s minus s prime is smaller than delta. I want the probability that this is greater than epsilon. I'm going to say that this will be bounded. Okay. As small as possible for any n. Okay. I can't find delta. Okay, so I should have said here, this is continuous in ST, this vanishes on the diagonal. Okay, if you take S equal T, well, this minimum is just ZS and everything vanishes, okay? So, because you have convergence in distribution, well, this object is also going to be small near the diagonal, by continuity if you want. So here, this is what I'm doing. I'm looking at S and S prime, which are close together, so near the diagonal. And I'm saying that then this quantity will be small. So the probability that it's greater than epsilon, well, if I choose delta small enough, I can make it as small as I wish. OK, it's just standard arguments in convergence in distribution. OK? OK, so perhaps I can erase that now. Let's take this one. Okay, so I continue, and what I say is that I'm going to take epsilon equals, say, 2 to the power minus k. I will find here some delta k, and eta, I'm going to take it also, say, replace it by eta times 2 to the minus k, something like that. And then I will sum the probability, and this will tell me that I can find a sequence delta k decreasing to zero, such that the probability of the soup of s minus s prime less than delta k of n to the power minus a quarter d zero n to ns prime greater than epsilon. I said I would take 2 to the power minus k. And in fact, I will have, okay, I will pass to the complement, okay? I will look at the probability of the intersection of all k of this, and this will be greater than 1 minus eta, okay? And I can arrange to have this, in fact, for every n, okay? Just from this with some manipulations, okay? Maybe I don't explain that too much. Okay, so then, so this gives you, essentially you get this for free. It's just a technical work. You get this for free simply from the fact that these processes converge to a continuous process that vanishes on the diagonal, okay? So now I want to come back to these objects. This is really what I'm interested in, okay? And the point is the following. If I look now at increments, basically I'm going to, I want to get some tightness for these objects. So I'm going to look at dn, say, of 2ns to nt minus dn of 2ns prime to nt prime. I just use the triangle inequality, okay? By the triangle inequality, this is smaller than dn to ns prime. Replace this by this, plus dn of 2nt to nt prime. Okay, the triangle inequality works because I'm looking at something which is a distance, okay, you see? So, and even it works also if I take linear interpolations, it's not difficult to see. And now what I'm saying is that simply dn is bounded above by dn0. So I replace dn by dn0. Okay. And I'm going to use what is above to say that if s is close to s prime and t close to t prime, well, these two quantities are going to be small. Okay. So this will tell me that the probability of the intersection of all k of the event where I suppose that s minus s prime is less than delta k, that t minus t prime is also less than delta k, of I take the event where this difference multiplied by n to the power minus a quarter is greater than, is smaller, say, than 2 times 2 to the minus k. This will have probability at least 1 minus, say, I lose a little bit, 2 eta. Okay, so why is it true? Because of the bound which is above, if this event does not hold, so this difference has to be larger than 2 times 2 to the minus k. So one of these two quantities here, this one or this one, has to be larger than 2 minus k. So this means that I will not have this event here. Okay? So I can bound the complement, if you want, of this event by twice the probability of the complement of this one. Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay. So it's just, well, maybe it's a bit technical. I'm sorry, but it's the last lecture, so I wanted to explain a little bit the technique between these results. Okay. But essentially, the idea is quite simple. You have the basic idea is this bound, dn smaller than d0n, the combinatorial lemma we saw before. And then since we have a very good understanding of the behavior of d0n, using the triangular inequality, we can also bound the increments of dn. Okay? So increments of dn will be bounded by quantities like this with s. Okay, if I take small increments for s and t, s and s prime are going to be close together. Close and t and t prime are going to be close. Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay. So, what does this give us? This tells us that the sequence of laws of this process here are tight. Okay. Because you see what you. If you look at the set of functions defined on 0, 1 square with values in R, so say R plus, such that they vanish at 0, and such that for every k, s minus s prime smaller than 2 to the minus k implies, and t minus t prime smaller than 2 to the minus k implies that. Phi of st minus phi of s prime t prime smaller than 2 to the minus times 2 to the minus k. Okay, so it should not be it should be delta k here, excuse me. Okay, well, this set is a compact subset of the set of continuous function on 0, 1. Okay, because you have this uniform equicontinuity of the functions. Okay, so this is telling you that with high probability these functions here belong to this compact set. Okay, so this is exactly the definition of tightness. Okay, so you may assume that this converges in distribution. It's not n. Okay, I wanted these the functions of s and t. Okay, you may assume that these random functions converge in distribution as n tends to infinity to a limit which I'm going to call capital D of st, st between 0 and 1. Okay? So you may assume that, but only, of course, along a subsequence. Okay, in what follows, I'm going to argue as if we had the real convergence at n tend to infinity, and we'll comment at the end on this subsequence. Okay, but tightness tells you that you can extract subsequences that are convergent. Okay, so this was the biggest step, second step, which I just finished now. It was it's really the hard part of the proof. Okay, let me give a third step. Maybe I should keep all these definitions. Well, I'm not going to use that anymore. Let me erase that. So the third step is going to be rather brief. So for the third step, I'm going to mention some properties of the limit that are not too difficult to obtain. And this capital D, well, basically, here I define it as a function of S and T, but in fact it will only depend on the points in the tree that correspond to S and T. So I claim that D of ST, say, equals D of, okay, let me say it this way, D of ST is equal to zero if S and T correspond to the same point in the tree. Okay, you still have the definition of the tree TE, well, not the definition, but the notation for this canonical projection. Okay. So why is it true? Well, basically, remember what was the definition for this equivalence relation. So we have the Brownian excursion. Essentially, we were identifying two points S and T if they had the properties that the value of the excursion at S was the same as the value of the excursion at T, and between, the value of the excursion is larger. Okay? If we have a picture like this. Now, think, so this is a Brownian excursion, and remember that the Brownian excursion is the limit of these contour functions. So maybe, for the arguments, at this point, we may assume that this convergence holds almost surely, just by using a score code, the representation theorem, and maybe I will also assume that we have here an almost sure convergence. It's just the classical score code theorem. Okay, can assume that they both this holds and this holds. Okay. Okay, I should have said that this convergence holds jointly with this one. Okay, so, by tightness, we can assume that. Okay, so just deal with the almost sure convergence to make things simpler. Okay, so the convergence which is there tells you that if you look at the contour function Seto n, well, asymptotically, it will look like the Brownian excursion because it converges uniformly. So basically, you will have something like this, okay? Perhaps. Of course, it's not the same function, but. Okay. Imagine that this is Seto n. This discrete curve converges. Well, you have to square it to scale it properly, of course. It's a scaled curve. Converges to this one, okay. And you have to scale also time. So,
would you comment on the difference between D star and D?
The goal is to say that D is equal to D star, but at the present stage I cannot do it.
And what you said, D is just
a limit on some. At the present stage, you know, I have this tightness property, so I can extract a convergent subsequence. So I have a random continuous function D, which is symmetric, satisfies the triangular inequality, and so on. I can say, in fact, that D is smaller than the D0, which is there, because this is just a consequence of this bound here, in fact. But I don't know that D is equal to D star. Okay. Just some limiting function.
Is it obvious that the properties of distance are satisfied for this limit?
Yeah, because
you have distances and then you have convergence.
This is symmetric in S and T, so this has to be symmetric. This satisfies the triangle inequality. This one satisfies the triangle inequality too, but you can pass to the limit. Yeah. Mm-hmm. No, it works. Think of an almost sure convergence. Okay, because
yeah, then you have to go through.
Yeah, you use score code. Yeah, uniform convergence.
Almost sure convergence, because just weak convergence does not gives a feeling that. This was a question: why the limit are preserved converges?
Sorry.
This was a question: why the limit properties are preserved convergence?
No, they pass on. They pass to the limit metric, the property of the metric. Yeah. Okay, so I come back here to this picture. So basically the idea is that if you have this configuration here, then you can find in the discrete setting a point here of the form kn over 2n, a point here of the form ln over 2n, in such a way that this time will converge to S, this time will converge to T, and you also have the property that, the same property here. So if you assume that we have the property I mentioned for S and T, you can approximate S by such times in such a way that you also have the fact that C to n of I is greater than C to n of kn equal to C to n of ln for any I between kn and l. Okay, meaning that the value of the contour will be the same at this point, and between it will be larger. Okay? So again, it's an argument of convergence. If you do it with weak convergence, it's you have to work a lot. But if you replace the weak convergence, and you are allowed to do that, it's not I'm not cheating here. By the Skowronski theorem, you can do it. If you have an almost sure convergence, not here, but here, of this object to this one, then if you just have to work a little bit to see that if you have this property here, you can find such kn and ln with all these properties. Okay. And once you know that, it's easy, because this property for the contour function tells you exactly that the point visited at time kn is the same as the point visited at time ln. Okay, so all this implies that un kn is equal to un ln. And so if you remember the definition of dn, it's telling you that dn, of course, of kn ln is equal to zero, because it's just the same point here. So two points will be the same. And so you pass to the limit, and you get that capital D of st is equal to zero, okay? Because you know that you have this convergence. Okay. Okay. So you write dn of kn ln is the same as dn of 2n times kn over 2n, 2n times ln over 2n. Okay. And this converges to S. This converges to T. And you pass to the limit. Okay. So this was a remark I wanted to make in the third step. Another remark also is the fact that this function D that I get in the limit is bounded above by D0. I already said it, but I can repeat the argument. It's a consequence of the fact dn greater than dn0. Okay, so I made a remark about that earlier. So dn0 is defined here, so you may say, well, it's not exactly the same thing as above, because there I had a max of two minima. Here I have only one minimum. But in fact, well, we could strengthen this. We could take also a max of the two minima going either from I to J or from J to I. There is a cyclic structure. Okay, so I don't want to give details for that. Really, this bound here, dn less than dn0, will give you capital D less than capital D0. Okay, so because you know that capital D is symmetric and satisfies triangle inequality, this is then you get the fact that capital D must be smaller than the D star introduced before, because D star was the largest symmetric function satisfying the triangle inequality smaller than D0. Okay? But of course, what you want to get is here is the equality. Okay. Okay, now I will come to the fourth step to finish. Well, because of what we have in the first step, we can view capital D really as a function on the tree. Well, in fact, it was a little bit, I should have said that earlier, okay? I've said this earlier, because to write this bound, my D star was defined on the tree, in fact. So I shouldn't, okay. Maybe I'm not doing things exactly in the right order, sorry. Okay. So why you can do that? But it's because it's written here, okay? Because you have this property. If you take two times S and T that correspond to the same point of the tree, their capital D distance is equal to zero. Okay, so if you want the third step, implies that if P of S equals PE of S prime, PE of T equals PE of T prime, all these two properties implies that D of ST equals D of S prime. Okay? Because you just use what I've written here together again with the triangle inequality. So now what I okay, so what I want to say now is that, I'm going to define again. Well, I use the same notation, but of course, same notation. I don't know yet that this is D is equal to D star, so, but okay. This is the ultimate goal, but for the proof, I can just take the same notation. A equivalent to B if B of AB is equal to zero. And because this capital D, it's written here, it's pseudometric, I can also look at the quotient space of the tree equipped with the distance induced by capital D, and this is a random compact metric space. So compactness is not easy, not difficult to get because, basically you are taking a quotient space of a compact space, it's again compact. That's not difficult. And so what you want to prove? Well, you want to prove that, the theorem, okay, which is still written there, but in fact I'm going to prove the theorem with D star replaced by T. Okay? So I forget the constant 9 over 8 to the power a quarter. Okay, so I want to prove that, and in fact, because I've used the score-code representation theorem to get almost sure convergence here and here, okay, I will prove that even almost surely. Okay, but remember that for the moment we are only arguing along a subsequence. Okay. Okay, so. How do we do that? But I'm going to use what I did yesterday, I mentioned that the Gromov-Hausdorff, so this is for convergence for the Gromov-Hausdorff distance. I'm going to use a bound for the Gromov-Hausdorff distance in terms of correspondences. Okay, now, so I'm going to build a correspondence between these two spaces and show that the distortion of the correspondence tends to zero. Okay, so what can I erase now? Well, this was not so important. I will finish the proof here. Okay, so I need one more notation. I will use a notation pi for the canonical projection from the tree onto the quotient space here. So I build a correspondence, so define a correspondence, I'm going to call it Cn, so between this space here, V of Qn, and the limiting space, this quotient space. By the following, well, Cn will be the set, it has to be a set of pairs of points, one in the first space, the other one in the second space. So for V of Qn, I'm going to take, using this contour function of the tree, contour sequence for sorry, of the tree, Un, say, integer part of 2nt. And the corresponding point here in this space, I will take the projection under pi of the projection under PE. So PE is the projection onto a TE of time t. Okay? I look at all these pairs for t between 0 and 1. So, well, this is not really a correspondence because I'm missing one point here. So if you remember, in the quadrangulation, I have, of course, all the points of the tree, all the vertices of the tree, but there is an extra vertex, partial d. So I have to put it in correspondence with some point here in this space. And what I can do, I can put it in correspondence with some projection PE of what I call S star. So S star is, more parenthesis here. What I denote by S star, it's time that corresponds to the minimum Z S star. This will be the minimum of the labels. It's not obvious that there is just one point that satisfies this, but in fact, this is the case. But I'm not really using it, in fact. It could be any point with this property, okay? So why that? You remember that in some sense, this extra vertex in Schaeffer's bijection corresponded to the minimal label. Okay? It was related to the vertices with minimum label in the tree. Okay? So I put it in correspondence here also with the point with minimal Brownian label. Okay? So this is my correspondence. So I have to bound the distortion of this correspondence. So maybe I will forget this. This is not difficult to. I will take two pairs of points in the correspondence, so of this form. So I take, say, un 2ns pi of p of s, and un 2nt pi of p of t. So these are two points in the correspondence. And I want to say that the distance between this, the first coordinate, this point and this one, is close to the distance between the second coordinate, between this point and this point. So I want to bound the difference between the graph distance between un 2ns and UN20. And the distance in the limit, this is what I call capital D, between these two quantities. I want to say that this is small when n is large, and this will tell me that when n is large, the distortion of the correspondence here is small. Okay, so I forgot to say, alors here it's important that I don't forget the scaling factors. Okay, because okay, I'm equipping my space with this renormalized. Where is the theorem? The theorem is here, the scaling factor here. Okay, so, but now that's very easy because this difference, well, this is equal to 9 over 8 to the power of a quarter, n minus a quarter. And by definition, this object here is just what I call the dn of 2ns 20. Okay, that's my definition. Well, it's still written here. Okay, and this object, I can remove the pi because okay. My definition of pi is that I identify points which are at d distance zero. I can also remove PE because okay, this is the way I define capital D. So this is the same as capital D of ST. Okay. And now, basically, essentially what I have proved is that we have the convergence of these quantities. So I should have put here the 9 over 8 also to the power of a quarter. These quantities converge to this one uniformly. Okay? If I look now at the soup of all ST, I know precisely what I have written there, that this converges almost surely to zero. Okay? And this gives me the convergence to zero of the distortion of the correspondence Cn. Okay? So I'm cheating a little bit because I should also consider pairs of this form here also. But trust me, it works exactly the same for these pairs. Essentially, this is what one is using. Okay, so once we know that the distortion of the correspondence tends to zero, well, by the result I mentioned yesterday, this tells us that exactly you have the convergence almost surely in the sense of Gromov-Hausdorff of these spaces here, space V of Qn equipped with the rescaled graph distance to the limit which is T quotiented equipped with D. Okay, so this is what we wanted to obtain. This is basically the theorem.
And minus 1
quarter. And minus 1 quarter. Thank you. Well, the same normalization as here, okay? So this is basically the theorem, except that I have not told you that this capital D, a priori, is not the same as the D star which is here. I only know that capital D is less than D star. And also, I used the tightness argument at some point. So this will work and only along the subsequence NP. Okay? So the proof of the theorem is not complete. And what you need to prove, to complete the proof, is to so end of the proof you need to show that D is in fact equal to D star. Okay? And once you know that D is equal to D star, you will know that the limit is uniquely determined. Okay? And since you have tightness, this will tell you that you don't need to take a subsequent. You really have a convergence as n tend to infinity. Okay? So this will give you really the theorem which is stated above. Okay? So now, okay, I must say that this is the hard part of the proof, okay? But it's very it's very technical. So I did not want to explain how this is proved because it's really too long. So for the next time I come to St. Petersburg, I can explain you the proof of this equality. So still, I think you have really the basic ideas, and you see why while we get in the limit this strange object. This strange object here, the tree quotiented by an equivalence relation, and so on. So conceptually, these are really the main step of the proof, but there is this point which is really delicate. So this is the end of the lectures. Thank you for your attention.